Okay, thank you very much, Alessandra. So this is working. Okay. Okay, it's a great pleasure to be here. I'd like to thank Alexandra and Pavel for the invitation. And so it's also my first time in Russia and Moscow, so I'm also very excited to see the city on the weekend. So, okay. So let's start with the talk. So this is a talk about usage mining techniques and applications to search and content recommendation. So I would like to start by first giving you some information about the place I'm coming from. So I'm a researcher in Yahoo Research in Barcelona. So this is a research lab of Yahoo. So overall, there are a number of research labs of Yahoo outside of the United States. So there is one in Barcelona, in Haifa, in Bangalore in India, and in Beijing in China. Okay. So we have a group of about 30 researchers, and these are some of the topics we are working in the lab. So we are working on web mining, on social media and multimedia retrieval, also on systems, large-scale distributed systems. On user engagement and semantic web. And this is a place that is quite open to academics, so every year we receive a lot of visitors. We have professors coming to visit us for some time, a lot of students. We also have interns coming, and actually Pavel was one of our bright interns, so this is how I met him. So among these groups, my area is on web mining. So this was the first theme. So this is in this area. We do some work on usage mining and query log mining, and quite a lot of work on social network analysis and graph mining, and also influence propagation. So this has become recently the focus of our research. So you have a lot of activity going on social networks. So we would like to know how users influence each other. And also, we do, in addition to the work we do with focus on products on Yahoo, we do some work on data mining, more theoretical work on algorithms and so on. Okay, and it's a very good place to work. There are many interesting data sources. So for example, query logs or toolbar, this is how people are browsing. Social networks, we have Flickr and Messenger and email and so on. Yahoo Answer is also very popular, and so this is a site that we get user-generated content, and we also are able to access Twitter data, and we can do research on that. So it's a very good, very exciting place to work, and a lot of problems. So in this work, I will focus more on the first item, so the work on usage mining and query log. In particular, I will talk about query graphs and how to do query recommendations, and also I will talk about a service that we built. We call it Yahoo Tips. So this was still in research, it's not in production yet, but we are hoping to get it out. And I will also talk about doing news recommendation using real-time web, in particular Twitter. Okay, so in the talk I will try to go over a large number of things, but I will try to stay at the same at a high level, not go very much into detail. So I will try just to give you the ideas, like the main ideas, not go in details. If you want to know more details, we can do in the questions afterwards, okay? And also some of these things are kind of independent, so there is not a continuous talk. So if you get to sleep at some point of the talk, you can wake up and probably there is still something that you can get. Okay, so I will start from the first item, which is query log and query recommendations. So as you probably know, Yahoo is a search engine, and search engines collect a large amount of data from query logs. So they record what the users query and how they react to these queries, what they type, what they click, and so on, how much time they spend clicking and looking at the results, and so on. Okay, and this is really a wealth of information. So there is a lot of interesting things that one can extract from this data. So you can analyze the behavior of the users, you can create profiles and do personalization, okay, and serve better answers to the users. You can create like knowledge bases and folksonomies, find similar concepts, or do query recommendations as we will talk. Okay, and one of the central themes of this area of query log mining is that so query logs is usually a messy and dirty and very complex and heterogeneous data set. So we try to simplify it a bit and represent it in a different way, in a more abstract way, and a more a way that is easier to understand. So there is a lot of work that try to represent query logs as graphs. Okay, so here you have such an example. It's an old paper by people in Microsoft. So where they introduce the click graph. So click graph is a bipartite graph where I have from one side queries and from the other side documents. So in this example, the documents are photos. So people are searching for photos, and then when you search for a panda, you get the photo of a panda, and then you might click on that. And so now you have this graph that, but this idea applies also to documents. It's not only when you have the photos. So we just saw it like that to make it more easier to visualize, but it's a general idea. And now there are a lot of useful things that you can do. So in that case, I have this bipartite graph, and I have also information on the edges. So how, if somebody typed this query panda and received as the answer this photo, how many times it clicked to the photo? So this means that this photo was a good response to the quizzer, to the query of the user. Okay, so I can view this as a graph, and I can do a lot of useful things. For example, I can annotate photos with queries, with tags and with queries. Or I can relate photos among themselves. So I can say that if these photos, both of these photos, have from they are related, they have many common neighbors from the queries, they are probably related, right? Or vice versa. I can relate queries if they have many photos from the other side. So, and indeed, this was what Craswell and Sumer was doing. So they say, okay, we have this graph, and we can do query to document search, query to query suggestion, document to query annotation, or document to document. So you can go all possible ways in this graph and extract information and use it. So so this is just an example of a click graph and what you can do. So what we did was kind of a somewhat similar idea, but in many respects also different. So in 2008, we had two visitors, Paolo Boldi and Sebastiano Vigna, visiting our lab. And we thought also the same, to take this large query log and build a graph. And our idea was to create a graph so that it's only a graph among queries. So we are not now between queries and documents, but we make a graph only between queries. And the motivation, the idea, the underlying concept was that this graph would capture the flow of the users, how like the flow of the user intent. When a user sits in front of the search engine and types something, and then say, oh, but this was not what I meant, and then makes a reformulation and types something else, so then the two queries are probably related. And so the user saw the results and interacted with the search engine, reformulate the query, and then create a second query, right? And then you can really put all of this information together, you can take the query log. So our idea was to make this the graph of the query that capture this notion of reformulation. So we say that our graph, the nodes of the graph are all the queries, and also I have a starting state and a terminal state. So this was before the first query that you when you start doing something, and terminal state is for the last query. Okay, and you also have edges that represent what is the probability that these two queries that are related with an edge, they are part of the same mission, the same chain, the same intent that the user has. For example, if a user is typing something about Moscow and then is looking for Moscow for restaurants or for going out to some entertainment, then this would be related if it happens in the same session. So the way we thought about that was to learn the weights on the graph in order to capture this concept of what is the probability that the two queries are related with one each other and they are part of the same mission of the user. Okay, and we decided to learn the weights using machine learning. So we aggregated a lot of features from the queries. So things like how similar are textual the queries, and also how many times these two queries happen together in the same session. What is the average time elapsed from one to the other? If the user click from going to one to another, and so on, right? And we aggregate all of them together. We use some editorial data, and we learn these probabilities. So this is an example of. So this is a real component of this graph. So for example, this is centered around Barcelona, and you see that. I don't know if this has laser. Okay. So so this is Barcelona. So you see here. This is the transition probabilities. How often, if somebody types Barcelona, types about Barcelona hotel, and this is a terminal query. So this is this means that when this user type that with transition probability 0.4, stop and didn't type anything else. And this is actually the thing that happened most often. So when people type something, most often it's a single query. They don't type anything else and they just stop. They switch to some other activity. Okay. So, and in addition to that, so we also thought about learning, annotating the graph with more information. So, one additional type of information we learned was the type of the transition. So we know that a user type from one query to another. Next, we're going to find what type is the transition. So here, I indicate with colors where. Blue means that they are parallel. So cat and dog, they are about at the same level. While if you go from a cat to a picture of cat, so going this way is a specialization, while going this way is a generalization. Okay? And this is again learned using the features that I told you about. Okay? And this is very useful because you can use it to make recommendations. So now the idea is to take this graph that we built, this structure, and try to do some query recommendations. So, and the general theme of doing this recommendation is that I am at some query that I have already seen this query by some past behavior in my system, and then I want to recommend other queries. So how I do it? So I first find other similar queries, I rank them, and I represent to the user, okay? And I can do the same for this idea. I can use it with any of this graph representation of query logs that we talk. So you can do it with a query flow graph that I just presented, or with a click graph, or with other types of graph that exist in the literature. So this is what we did. Okay, so we say now how I'm in this starting some query and I want to find other similar queries. So you can just follow the weights out and go there. Another way is to do some random walk. So instead of if you want to say that sometimes you don't just follow one edge, but you might want to follow different paths. So there might be a path that has high probability. So there might be another node. Because it has high probability, because there may be many paths that arriving to that, and all of them with significant probability, and the probability adds up, and then you might get a better recommendation. So, if you want to measure the relation of the of these two queries, of one being recommendation for the other, so there is a. Existing technique to do that is called the page rank with restart. So also personalized page rank that you do this this random walk is measured as a page rank, and then at some certain, with some random probability, you go back to your initial query, and then you can see what is the, you can assign a score to the other nodes, and you can use that to do recommendation. So here is an example of what happens. And so in this case, we have this, let's say, this query, Apple. And now I present, in this example, four different schemes. So here is what happens if I just follow the edges with a maximum weight. Okay? So one thing that happens is that you get queries like Amazon or iTunes on like this online shopping or things like that, that are become very popular, and they are edges that have high weight, even though they are not related with the original query I'm starting. Okay, and the reason for this is this, because these are very popular queries in general. So it's very likely that somebody types Amazon even after any query, even if it doesn't have any relation with the query that you start. Okay, and this is what you get. So this is just following the maximum weight. On the other hand, this is the recommendations that you get if you do the personalized page rank with restart to Apple. Okay? And again, you have the same problem that popular queries like Google and Amazon. So, and yes, it's true. People use Yahoo search engine to search for Google. So they this come very high just because they have very high personalized page rank in general. Okay? So the way to address this problem was to do some kind of normalization. So we say, okay, these queries are not related, but they have very high personalized page rank score, but they also have high page rank score also, not just personalized, but in general, right? So if you do some page rank with no personalization, they get high weights, and this is the reason they also get high personalized page rank score. So we try to do this normalization and divide by those scores, okay? And we have different personalization schemes, and indeed they go away, and you get things that are more related, and you see that you get also things related to the fruit or to the technology company. Okay, and this is different schemes of personalization. And one nice thing about this idea of doing this recommendation with restart is that it can be applied even if you have more history about the user. So for example, not only if you know the query that the user has typed, but also some of the previous history and some of the previous queries of the user. Okay? So in this case, for example, okay, it's an artificial case, but I know that the user type Apple, and I know that the previous query of the user is banana. Okay? So now you see that I really focus on the fruits, because now I get more score to these queries. While if I know that, okay, in that case, the previous query is beetles, and it happens that I get a lot of things from the music group Beatles and so on. And here, the hidden piece of information that you might know, and also I did not know before, was that Apple is the record company that Beatles recorded a lot of songs. Okay, so this is also very relevant, and this indeed shows some type of disambiguation happens. Okay, so this is only just anecdotal evidence to give you some high-level idea. I don't go into more details and graphs of more formal evaluation, just to tell you how you can use this query flow graph to do interesting things. But in general, also before I was discussing with people with people here in Yandex, and the problem of evaluation came up. So how do you evaluate, and how do you try to optimize? So how do you build a recommendation system that has a clear objective, that a clear objective function? So this was another question that we tried to address. So we say that, okay, one way is that how I evaluate a recommendation system. One way is to say that I create a golden truth of evaluation by human editors, Okay, and then I have my recommendation system, and then I try to predict every time I have a new algorithm. I see how well this algorithm does compare to this golden truth. Okay, so and but then we said, okay, how we could do it in a different way. So how I can set this problem of recommendation as a clear optimization problem that I want to find some clear optimization. So here is the setting. So we say, okay, look at this graph and imagine that this is the query flow graph that I was talking about. So these are the queries and these are the transition on this query. So this has been found by our model, our query log model. And imagine now that on top of this information, I also have some utility score. So these are. So imagine that I know how satisfied the user would be if the user would type these queries, okay? And in this like graphical representation, I know that, for example, this have very high reward. So I know that I will get a lot of benefit if the user types that query, okay? And this would be somehow less, and these are not so good reward, okay? And this is some utility. So it could be how good is the page or how I can monetize from that query, and so on. And now the problem of query recommendation becomes a problem of maximizing my reward. So I say, I know that I have modeled the user, the behavior of the user, as making a random walk on this graph, and I know that by making this random walk, you get some reward on the way. Okay, so now I want to somehow add some edges, add some shortcuts that at the end they are going to increase my reward. So for example, if I know that this is the query that I'm starting, so I say that I will try to make recommendations towards this way, going down, in order to make the user pass from a high reward state. Okay, and for example, I might consider the case that if the user make a reformulation going from here to here, then I will still make the recommendation towards that query here in order to maximize my reward. Okay? So this approach assumes that I know that I have this utility, so that these utility scores are available to me, and it is possible to get them. Okay? But as we see and as we say in the paper, there are nice ways and there are proxies to these utility functions. So in that case, by doing these red recommendations, what happens essentially is that I change my graph and I have a new graph, because now there is more. It's more likely that the user will make these transitions, because these are the recommendations that I will make, right? So it's more likely that it will collect some more reward. So, okay, so we formulate this problem, and we say that I want to model a user behavior as a random walk on this query flow graph that we define. So the idea is that the user starts from some query, it makes a random walk, and then collects some reward, okay? I assume that I have some utility function, some reward function on the nodes, and the goal is to make the user go through certain paths, passing through certain nodes on this graph, okay? And we consider two alternatives. One is that we collect the reward as we go, so every time that you visit a node, you take some reward, or the other alternative is that you get a reward at the end. Assuming that the end was really your goal, then you get some reward when you reach the end and you reach your goal, okay? And this is a general problem. It's not only for query recommendation. So it can be applied, for example, when you design a front page of a site and you want to put a links in order to help the user navigate, and you know that you have certain utility by passing through some pages, then you can, again, apply this framework and try to reason of how you will create the links in order to maximize your reward. Okay? So, and of course, we assume a probabilistic model. So we cannot force a user visit a page. We only can recommend, so we somehow nudge the user through a certain node. So essentially, when we have our query flow graph is modeled some from using some stochastic matrix P, and the recommendation is modeled again in some probabilistic way. So now I have a new random walk P prime, which is the sum of the two. Like P is in some sense what the user is intending to do anyway, and R is the recommendations that we will do to the user. Okay, and as I said before, again, so there are many natural ways to think about what would be the reward, what will you get when you pass from those queries. For example, you can have some proxy of how good are the search results for that query. Okay, you can obtain it from the query log and from various metrics. User satisfaction, dwell time, how long the user stays on the results when the user types this query, right? Or even, so all of these measures try to optimize satisfaction for the user. You can even try to think about monetization. So you might want to push a user to a query that you collect more advertisement, if this is what you want to maximize. So essentially what we are saying here is that we don't care. We are agnostic. We just assume some reward function, and we let to the designer design what is the reward function. Okay, and these are the two ways to have the utility function I talked before. So one is that you collect from all the nodes, and this is you collect only at the last node. So in the paper we make this kind of joke that this is that you get some reward from all the way, and the way to the trip, the trip to the end is the means, while the other approach to take just from the last is just that the end satisfies the means. Okay, and the idea here was that some of the authors were Greek and some Italian, so these quotes were fitting somehow nicely. Okay, so this was some framework how to use the query flow graph and make recommendations. Okay, I'm going to skip some part, and I'm going to talk about a second problem that we address and how we extend the query flow graph to a different concept. And the idea here is again the problem of query recommendation, but we want to make recommendation for long tail queries, okay? So for very rare queries. So let's see what's happening. So we want to improve the coverage of our query recommendation system. So if you go to some search engine and you type some query, you see that you get some recommendations. Very often you get recommendations, but very often you don't get recommendations. So if you type a query that is a little bit strange and somehow rare, you won't receive any recommendation. And this was the problem we wanted to address. We say, okay, how can we reason about making recommendations even for rare queries, okay? And actually, rare queries are very common. So most of the queries are rare. So an observation made some time ago, but it holds like still, I mean, in any query log that you look, is that in a typical query log, 50 times of the queries are unique queries. So these are, you take a query log and half of them appear only once. So a user, some query appears and never appear again. Okay? So all of these methods that I describe, they are not going to work on this type of queries because you have never seen this query before. You have not introduced the query to your graph in your model. You don't have anything about cold curing this query because you have not seen before. So you cannot say anything about that query. Okay? So this is an inherent limitation of all of this approach. So, and the problem we want to solve is how to develop methods to do recommendations for rare queries, even for queries that you have not seen before. So you see a query for first time and you make a recommendation. Okay, so what was the idea? How we thought about doing this problem? So let me give you an overview, just telling you the main idea. So the main idea is to generate what we called query templates. Okay, so we try to generalize the queries to kind of types of queries. So for example, if I see the query Paris hotels, I say, haha, this is a query that has a type city hotels, because I know from some previous knowledge that Paris is a city, okay? And if I see, but I can also, Paris is also a district, okay? So I can also generalize to a different concept, to a different template, okay? So, and I might see this query again, like I see the query Moscow hotels, okay? And I say again, city, Moscow is a city, so here I have an underlined template. And now I observe that this template is the same. So these two queries have the same template. Okay? So what does this mean? This means that when I see, okay, and assume that I observe in my query log that people who search sometime about the hotels of a city, then the restaurants in the city. Okay? So I also make this inference from my query log. Okay? And we will see how it's possible to make this inference. So now, what does this mean is that I can make recommendations for rare queries. So if I see now this query, Yangcheng Hotels, where Yangcheng is some city in small city in China, that it's not, people don't typically submit this query, I immediately make the inference and say, look, this is, I know that this is a city, so I'm here, and I know that people who search for cities then search for restaurants, so I can make this recommendation, Yangcheng recommendations, okay, by making this inference. And this inference I'm going to learn from my query log. So this is the idea. So in order to make this idea work, you need the concept of a template. A template here is defined over a hierarchy of entity types. So we will see exactly what is happening. And we define the templates on the whole query logs. We are not restricted to a domain such as travel or weather or movie. Okay, so here are some examples of templates. So I saw you already some, so these are some more examples. So if I have Jaguar spare parts, I know that Jaguar is a car. Okay, so this could be a template. Of course, Jaguar is an animal, so I could have another template, okay? And as you will see, we will also generate this template, and then we have to reason about all of these templates that we generate, okay? Another example, name for salt. So somebody is looking for the chemical name of this chemical compound, and I can extract from my knowledge base that salt is a compound, so I can substitute salt with the template and with a type, and I have the template, and I can keep generating these types of templates. So the way I need to do that is to have somewhere to have this access to this knowledge base, to know that salt is a compound and Paris is a city and Moscow is a city and so on and so forth. Okay, but this is not so difficult to find. There are already out a lot of hierarchies about knowledge base. So in this example, I have some knowledge base that I know that chocolate is a drink, but also a food, and cookie is a dessert, and so on, right? So when I see my query, so my query in this case is chocolate cookie recipe, I can start generating candidate templates. So I say, okay, chocolate is a food, so I have this one. But chocolate is a drink, I have that one. But also chocolate cookie together is a dessert, which is a food. Okay, so I can have this one. And also I know that recipe is an instruction, so I can have that one. So you see now that starting only with one query, I can generate many of these possible templates. And this could be, this has to be, we have to deal, so this is going to be a problem, and we have to address this problem. What do I do now after generating all of these templates? What I need to do is a way to rank these templates and distinguish which is a good template and what is a bad template. Okay, so let's see some examples. So this example we saw already. So I might have problems of ambiguity. So I know that Jaguar is both a car and an animal, but when I compare with spare parts, so that this is a good template, but the animal is a bad template. So I have to learn this from my data. And I also have to learn other things, like to find out where is the right focus, where should I put the type in order to produce the template. So for example, I know that for this query, this template has to be ranked higher because the emphasis here is on salt and not on the description. So if I'm typing this query, I'm not looking for the this is the right right template, right? Because I usually look for names of chemical compounds, so I should emphasize that. And I should also be able to generalize at the right level. Again, we saw again this example when my query is Paris Hotel. I have many options even for one term of the query. I can say the hotel is a capital or is a city or a location. So all of them are true, and I'm going to generate all of them. Okay, so in the experiments, we used WordNet 3.2 and Wikipedia category hierarchy, and we connect them using the Yago mapping. So this was how we built this knowledge base. And the queries were tokenized, as you saw in these small examples, and we have some special rules, but it's not important. And then we start to assigning scores. We say, okay, first, I'm going to make a connection from a query to template. So the way to go from a query to template is this hierarchy I saw you before. And the question basically is how high I will go, okay? And we assign a score that exponentially decreases with a high. So if I go very high, to the very high level of the generalization, I get very low score. If I go, the lower I get, the higher the score I get, right? So alpha is a constant less than one, okay? Then I also have transitions from template to template, okay? So as we see, for example, this is a transition from template to template. I say from, because both contains types, and from food recipe, I go to healthy food recipe, okay? So now I want to score this kind of transitions and see how good they are. So the way to do that is by looking at the support. So essentially, I'm looking at the support, and I say, I define support the number of individual queries that are instantiated in that temple. Okay? For example, dosa is a food, it's a type of food. Okay? So if I see a transition, two individual queries, one is dosa recipe and the other is healthy dosa recipe, I know that this pair support this rule. Okay? And now I say that the score of this rule, I just sum over the support, the score of the pairs that support it. Okay? And we see, now let's see an example how this helps me to deal with ambiguity. So, as we said before, if I see, for example, Jaguar transmission goes to Jaguar spare parts, where here, so the user type this query and then type in a different way, is looking for what the user is looking, and I say, okay, Jaguar wants to go to car, okay, but Jaguar can also go to animal, this is the other type. So the thing is that this transition here supports this template transition, okay, because when this happened, this is supported. And at the same time, if the user searches for the same kind of query, but instead of Jaguar, says for BMW or for Audi, all of this, because W and BMW and Audi are both cars, these query transitions also support the template. Okay, so immediately I can increase my score on the templates. Okay, on the other hand, if I was about to evaluate how good is from Jaguar to animal, I see now that this query here supports this template, but if I had lion transmission to lion spare parts or with tiger so these are not going to happen because there is no car called lion or tiger and so on. So this transition will have much lower score compared to that one. Okay, and so this is how my system will deal with ambiguity. So this is the main idea, and then what we did is to overlay the two, to take these transitions we find and we put them on top of the query flow graph, and then whenever we want to generate recommendations, we go, so traditionally in this query flow graph, I just go from query to query, but here I can go through templates. And if there are many templates, I can sum over many of them, okay? And I can overall sum and take the probability of the most feasible path, okay? And this part, the part with color here, is my query template flow graph that I have generated, and all of this, the scores I have learned offline. But these dotted lines here are what I do online. So from the moment I see the query, even if I see this query for first time, then I'm able, using my knowledge base, to abstract and go to templates and then make the recommendation using my templates. Okay, so this is the idea. So we evaluated this idea. We compare how well it does compared to the query flow graph. So this was our baseline method, and this was the method that takes into account the templates. And we did various types of results. First, we visually evaluate them. We see how look they good, how good they look. And and we also perform some editorial evaluation, and we also try to do some automated evaluation. So this was the data set we use. So we use some snapshot of the query log we had in Yahoo. So this is an interesting point here. You see that I start with 95 million queries, and I go to 5 billion templates. So I expand, like, on average, for each query, I generate about 600 templates on average. Okay, so I really expand. But we say, okay, this is something that I can afford. It's not so horrible. I can do it if, in fact, I can get a better system that satisfies my goal of doing recommendations that have better coverage. So here are some examples of things we are able to find, right? So again, all of these are queries that never appear before, and we are still able to do very reasonable recommendation based on some template. Okay, so we did some editorial evaluation where we saw that essentially, in cases that the query is common and I have seen it before, that the idea of the templates performs about the same. So here is a little bit worse, and here is a little bit better. But in cases that this method cannot do anything, so for queries that I have not seen before, so query flow graph cannot do anything, while here I get quite reasonable precision, right? And finally, we also did automated evaluation. So here is to be able to predict query transitions that I have not used to build my system. So take the query log and see pairs of queries that the user has is submitting to the system, okay? And then if the user submits two queries in the same session, I assume that they are related, and this could be a good recommendation for the other, okay? And then I look at my method. So how both of these methods, are they good to make this recommendation QI plus one for QI? So this is the idea. And what we see is that, so these are the two methods, the query flow graph and the query template flow graph, that overall the coverage improves, so on the overall volume, and the precision is also very good. So if you look, for example, this transition from QI to QI plus one, if you look at the top 10, the query flow graph has precision at 10%, while the query template flow graph has precision about 20%. Okay, so it's more than 100% improvement, and different measures. Okay, So, and perhaps the last thing is that also here I have the precision in the top 10 queries as a function of the query length. So, and the black line is the query flow graph, and the purple line is the query template flow graph. So, essentially, as the query becomes larger, the making a recommendation becomes more difficult, okay? But the, using the templates, it has a peak at 3. So, sorry, from at 2. So, going from 1 to 2, because you have a little bit of room and you can apply this technology of templates. Okay, so this was... this was part of the talk about the query graphs and the query recommendations. Now, so now I'm going to move in the second part of the talk, where this is going to be a short part. I'm going to talk about the Yahoo tips. So this is one system we are playing, and this was work we did with Ingmar Weber and Antti Ukkonen. And I believe that Ingmar was here a few weeks ago, right, or days? I don't know. And from what I know, I checked, he has not talked about this part, but about this work. So the idea here, so this is less researchy, this part. So it's just some nice system that we would like to build. So the idea is that when you type, when you make a query and you look at the result, very often you see these links and you have to click on the links. But very often you don't see the links. You get immediately the result that you want, right? If you search for weather, you get a nice box and you see the weather there. Or if you search for a celebrity, you get some photos, which is perhaps what you are looking for. Okay? And very often this is good. So this improves the satisfaction of the user, so people are happy and they like that. So we would like to design a system like that gives immediately some answers, and perhaps not the final answer, but just a nice tip, so some advice to the user who is searching, okay, something interesting, so some smart, short piece of advice that is concrete, self-contained, and not obvious. Okay, so this was what we would like to do. So let's see some examples. So here the user is searching for fresh eggs. So you get like your links about different things, and then you have a tip here. It says to tell if your eggs are fresh. Place eggs in a bowl, glass of water. If it flows, it's bad. If it sinks, it's good. Okay. So you immediately get some kind of tip. It might not be what you are looking for. Okay. When you might want to find where I want to buy search eggs. But this is perhaps something interesting that you see it is surprising and you say, ah, it's like a wow, let's say. Okay? So this is what we wanted to do. And this is not a mock-up. It's not something that we really, I type and I design with a PowerPoint. So this was really a screenshot from the system we built. Okay? Let's see another one. So round decimal C. Okay? So, and then you have a tip of what you like it even contains some kind of C code of how you round some some number, right? And okay, this is good. So zest lime. So zest is when you take the outside of the lime. So this is called zesting. So it says. And there is some, apparently, if you are into cooking, there is some small device that allows you to zest a lime. So here the tip is to zest a lime. If you don't have a zester, use a cheese grater. Okay? So things like that. So this was the system that we would like to build. So how we do that? So, okay, as you might saw, we did it by taking these tips from Yahoo Answers. So Yahoo Answers is this query answering system that people use to ask questions and answer questions, and it's like this user-generated content. And so here you see how I have some question-answer pair. Okay, so this is from Yahoo answers, and now the idea was to parse this this system and produce a tip. So if you see, so this was only the so from that part up to the colon, I use the question part, and for the second part, I use the answer. Okay, so there is a lot of kind of engineering and rules and techniques and on how to do that. And one thing that so we try to be very careful is that now Yahoo Answers is big and it has there are many questions that they cannot be seen as deep. There are also many questions and answers that have very bad quality, right? So we try to build a system that extracts only the question answers of the best quality, and we try to transform it to make it deep, and then we have to match them to queries in order to serve the user query as a deep. So this is the idea. So this is the diagram of the system. So what we do is that we start with a Yahoo Answers repository. Then we apply some rules. We learn. We extract a lot of tips, but then we extract only the higher quality of them. So in order to do that, again we do some manual evaluation to learn a small example of good quality tips. We do that using the Mechanical Turk. Okay, and then we use this label example in order to label all our tips, all our database. Okay, so we from the Mechanical Turk we got about 2,000, and then we use this as a training set in order to learn about 22,000 high quality tips. Okay, and then when the query comes, in that case Zest Align, I have first to build a module that checks if the query has a how to intent. Is this really a query that if I that answering a how to tip is relevant or not? Okay, and if no, oh, sorry, if no, I don't show a tip. If yes, then I say okay. Is the now for that query? Can I match it to some high quality tip? And if yes, only then I show the tip. Okay. And in that case, that was the tip. So this is the idea. So I don't want to spend a lot of time on that. It's kind of simple idea. So just a few things that we consider tips to have only this specific structure, where it has a goal, so to do something, and then so this is the question and this is the answer. Okay, and then we apply a lot of rules how to parse the Yahoo Answers and extract these tips. And then we use, as I said, we use the this Crowdflower is a service on top of the Mechanical Turk in order to label them. Okay, and once we label them, we use machine learning algorithms to learn the model and label all the tips that we had extracted, and we use a lot of handcrafted features like how well written it is, if it has many punctuation, if it has emoticons, URLs. So all of this, we use it as a features, and we learn them. Okay, and so and another thing is that when we design the system, we don't really want to show for all queries a tip. We just want to show one when we are certain, very sure that this is a good tip. So we aim for a system that has very high precision, and we don't care so much about the recall. So whenever we make the suggestion, we want this to be a good. And if we don't make, it's okay, we don't. So you see, for example, that we are able to perform. So for example, for some of the machine learning algorithms we use, we are able to. To have it, so now the two columns are precision and recall. So I can have precision of about 94%, but the recall is very low. Okay. So and if you want to have higher recall, then you have to suffer. Yeah. Okay. So. So hard. Okay. So yeah, it's a bit. So hard means this. This is yes, and this is no. So I say. So when we obtain this data from Mechanical Turk, I ask the people to give three labels: very good, okay, and bad. So if I want to separate very good from the rest, then this I call this hard. So now my tips are high quality. If I want to separate bad from the rest, I call this soft. So now my tips are kind of less good quality. So and it turns out that the soft task was easier than the hard task. But okay, so and then the last question, I will skip this, is to see how many queries, so how many of these queries I can really answer with tips. So and from our studies, we saw that I can have a 2 or 3% of volume of the query that I can, they are good to serve as how to, or 3 or 4% of distinct queries, right? Not looking at the volume, but looking at the distinct. And in order to achieve these figures, again, we have to use a lot of engineering and a lot of tricks. Like we say, if a query starts with how to, then it's obviously a how to query. If a query starts with an action verb, then it's also a how to query. So play my music on toolbar radio, right? So this is also a how to. So and the trick here is it starts with a verb. And if there is a query that says how to and there how to x and there is another query x, so I can assume that x is basically a how to. So we had tricks like that, and then we are able to say that for 2 or 3 percent of the queries are how to queries, I'm able to detect them, and then for those queries I can serve a tip. Okay, so I would like to, and this is the performance of the system, you can find the details. I would like to skip and go to the third and final part, so I can have 5 more minutes? Okay. So, okay, now the last part is also, so this is more recent work. Okay, actually I have some, I had to prepare more slides than this time, always. So the last part, is more recent work I have done with my colleagues, so the Gianmarco De Francisci Morales and Claudio Lucchese. And so this is different in the sense that it's not about the search engine anymore. So now this problem, we have it for Yahoo News, so we want to recommend news articles to users, okay? And we want to do that by leveraging information that we have on Twitter. So this is the idea. So we want to build a news recommendation system based on a real-time web, and we want to suggest news articles to Twitter users, okay? And our goal is to infer user preferences both from the interaction they have with the news system, but also with the Twitter account, who they follow and what they write on the Twitter, essentially. So this is the system we have in mind. So you go to Yahoo News, you see some news, and here there are some news for you. So these are according to some module. So that is, but in this case they are not really so personalized, okay? But what we're going to do is to say, okay, now if you give us your Twitter account, I'm able to give you even more news that are really good. So they are very personalized for you, okay? So you link your Yahoo account to your Twitter account, and then I give you more suggestions for news, okay? So this is the high level idea. This is what we want to do. And why we want to do that? Because we want to combine the two, news and Twitter, because those are two different sources that they have different characteristics, and they work. One is it works well in some cases, but the other works better in some other cases. So, for example, news have very high coverage, right? But they are also very sparse and noisy data for user profiling. So users, you know, read some news, click. They are not so active typically when they read the news, right? And also it takes some time when, so something happens and then the news comes within a few hours, and the user might read within half a day or one day. So it's not really real time. So it takes some time until I collect this information, right? So on the other hand, so Twitter can be used to counterbalance these negative points. So it is much more personalized because people are more active in providing some Twitter information, and the news spread very fast. Okay, so let's have an example. So when we are doing the research for this paper, it was last year in May, where the news about Osama bin Laden came out, and then we see the peak. So the green line is the Twitter. So you see the activity on Twitter that contained the term Osama bin Laden. So this comes very fast. So people, it's really get to tweet about that, but, and then it fades down, okay? And it's a little bit faster than when it comes with the news, okay? And the red line is the reads. So how the people who click and read about the story, okay? So you see that it takes quite few hours from the moment the news came out to the Twitter, from the time the people get to read and know about that. Okay, so I guess the thing here is Twitter users also, they try to be very very fast, and if something is sold, they don't bother about that. So they lose interest much more fast. Okay, so and then another similar figure is when I see the delay on the click. So this is the delay from, like, if a news story is published at time zero, this is the distribution of the clicks when people are clicking to this story. Okay, and I see that most of the clicks are between 1 hour and 1 day. So before 1 hour, people don't have the time to read, and then after 1 day, the news is not news anymore. So they don't read it. Okay. So, but most of them are closer to, you need many hours. It's not like Twitter that things are becoming very fast. So we want to build a system that addresses these challenges. So it scales to large volumes. And so we want to build a really simple system that is able to scale well and handle the large volume that I have of Twitter and of news, okay? And news have very short life cycle. And also another important issue is that Twitter users are using a lot of jargon. So this is also something that you have to deal with. Right? And we also have to find the right level of personalization. Some users might like very personal news, some others might like the general news, and also some users are inactive, so they don't tweet so much. So in order to bring these three things together, the news, the tweets, and the user, we use the concept of entity. So entity is, so we parse the news and the tweets, and we extract entities, okay? And now we represent all of these three concepts on the space of entities. So it's user, its news is represented as a vector of entities, its tweet again as a vector of entities, and its user again as a vector of entities of either the news that the user has read or the tweets that the user has read or write. Okay? So the architecture of the system is the following. So the bubbles here is the Twitter network. So I have a user that tweets some things, okay? And I have other users who are, so this user is following those users, and those users also tweet, okay? And in addition, and separate of that, I have all the tweets and all the news that are available in our system. So I take all of these components and I make a model for the user. And the model consists of all of these components. So in particular, the model tells me what the user writes, so these are the tweets of the user, what the reader reads in terms of tweets, okay? And also what is happening in general in the Twitter and in the news. So what is the more popular thing that are happening right now? Okay, these are part of the user. So this is not the personalized part. So this is the generic part. So the personalized part is what the user is reading and what the user is writing. Okay, and I combine these two in order to make some personalized news recommendation for the user. And our model is very simple. So it just combines these three things. So it's what the user... So the model is a ranking function that ranks how good is a news article for the user. Okay? So it has... It says what is the relevance with respect to the entities, like for the user reading that or writing, or how popular is this thing, right? So these are the three different components. And we also have to update popularity, because as I told you before, so news become obsolete very soon. So we have a component of how popular are the entities, and then this the popularity decay exponentially. So use a simple exponential decay rule to update the popularities. So the idea here is to, and now we want to evaluate the system to see how well the system does. So in order to do that, we use automated evaluation, and we do it through the Yahoo toolbar. So Yahoo toolbar is an add-on that some people install it, and it records all the browsing behavior of the user. Okay, so now we know what are the pages the user visits, even outside of Yahoo, not only inside Yahoo. Okay, so now I see that if some user clicks on some news, then I say, okay, that could be a good recommendation for that user. And now I look, does my system makes a recommendation for that click of the user? Okay, so I can measure the precision with respect to this prediction task. And the model we built actually is a machine learning model. So it has these parameters, alpha, beta, gamma, of how to combine these different different modules and the rules about different other types of weights and popularity. So we use a machine learning model to learn these parameters, and we have the basic model that uses learn those parameters, and we also have some enhanced system that learns it uses additional features basically. And now, okay, and now what we see is that, so these are, if I have all of this, so well, I measure the precision at 1, 5, and 10 according to this task I told you to predict if a click of the user is also a recommendation from my user, right? So I have this prediction task, and I also see the coverage, how many of these predictions I'm able to find. And I see when I use different families of features, then, like for example, let's see. So for example, this is if I use only the content, it has good precision but low recall. Okay, while the system with high recall, they have low precision. And the system that learns the weights from these different families of features is able to combine to achieve high precision and high recall. I mean, compared to each one of them. Okay, so, and this is some similar plot for average discounted cumulative gain for the different features and for the systems. Okay? So in conclusion, we saw how we use the real-time web and Twitter in particular in order to deliver relevant information to users. And this is work that we are actually pursuing, and we want to we are developing this system to be in the production. So some thing that we are looking is to do LSI in order to have a better representation of entities, not just because this is quite noisy. So right now we have this model that for each user we have one set of parameters. So now there might be some users that behave different from other users. So it might be classes of users, right? So we would like to cluster the users and find what is the right set of parameters for each cluster, right? Or you can look for other information like geographical information that might help you give better recommendation. It's quite obvious actually that people in different countries or different states in the United States should receive different recommendations, more local news and so on. So in summary, like of the talk, we talk about various concepts of query log mining and how to do the recommendations. We also saw how to do news recommendation using Twitter, and I think this is an area that has very nice open problems and research opportunities. And thank you very much.
To be honest, when I received your slides, I was really scared because there are something about 120 slides. But now I see that all of them were really helpful, and thank you especially for bright examples of queries. So now you have a great opportunity to ask Aris about his report or if you want to clarify some details. So please just raise your hand and I will come to you and give the microphone. Could you also introduce?
Okay, hi, my name is Vladimir. I have a question. So do you plan or do you already analyze somehow the social activities in connection with query flows, like you do with Twitter? Do you analyze maybe Facebook or any other social networks to offer a user the way which his query flow will go?
Thank you. So the problem here is data. So we don't have the Facebook data. We have Twitter data, as we saw, but as probably you I apologize. I passed some of these slides very fast, and so we were able to identify 3,000 users who have both Yahoo News log into the Yahoo News with a Yahoo account, and also have Twitter, okay? So this is a fairly small number. And this, we did it using some kind of a hack. So we really designed some hack to try to match them, okay? It doesn't seem so easy. Like, you know, it's not only, even if the data exists, sometimes there are politics. So, for example, there are privacy issues that does not allow us to do this, to match the different profiles of the users, and to publish this paper, the saying that we did this kind of approach and we joined the Twitter users, we had to talk to the lawyers and ask them, okay, this is okay to do it, and it's for research and we don't look at the so in principle, yes, I think this is a great area to work, and it has a lot of opportunities and nice problems, and I think it's going to be very important. In practice, it doesn't look so easy because of various practical issues. Yeah, I don't know how our things are here. If you have, I was talking before, and I was asking about the same issue. If Yandex has some data about. Social data. I was told that there is some blog system that, but I don't know if in the analysis are people using to join the two and bring them together and do some joint analysis. Yeah.
More questions?
Can you tell a bit more about this query recommendation? It's just...
I was talking for 1 hour.
No, how often people use it? So is it a practical problem?
Or yes, so it's very practical. So I'll tell you one story. So at some point, I was telling you... you have a lot of these different algorithms and you try different algorithms, and the way to test them is you do, so in Yahoo, you call it bucket test. So when you have a new algorithm and you want to test how good it does, so you implement the algorithm and you take a small fraction of the traffic and you you serve these people this new algorithm, and then you measure different metrics, right? And you see how good it does. So at some point, some like 2 or 3 years ago, we said, okay, we have all of these different algorithms, and for each one of them, we have measures, and we have this dashboard, and we see how good each one of them it does. But what if we create a bucket that doesn't have any recommendation at all, right? And then we say, okay, let's create such a bucket with no recommendation, if not for other reasons, just to have it as a baseline and as a reference, and in order to, you know, for some of our ideas, we wanted to measure some things to see how the user behave when the user is not influenced by the recommendation, right? So we create this bucket that doesn't have any recommendation at all. And the idea was to have this bucket for 1 week and collect data from 1 week. And what happened is that after 2 or 3 days, they tell us, you know, this bucket is really losing a lot of money, all the metrics are down, so we have to stop it. So it really, it's something that people use and they like to see, and they click, and yeah.
You want to add?
Thank you, that was interesting. What about your model? So you try to optimize some utility function showing this recommendation, right. Recommendations. Have you tried to take into account the possibility to abandon the system? So sometimes people don't use this recommendation, they just input another query or click some results without using this recommendation.
Yeah, so this is just... So this module has two components. So first is, so you might want to make a recommendation of something of another query that has very high utility. Okay, so and now you are tempted to do that. You say, okay, because this has very high utility, I'm going to recommend to that query no matter what. I mean, everything that you type, I will recommend you to that query, right? But this is not going to work because now you also have what is the connection between the two queries. So if you see that you know that these two queries are irrelevant, so even though it has high utility, the weight of going from the one to another is going to be very small, so this is not going to help you. So this is going to be counted in this way. I don't know if this answers.